So in that digital office hour, we are going to continue with the Feynman Kutch application. So which means we are now in video one and we want to apply the Feynman Kutch theorem to the Vasicek bond pricing model. So therefore, here I kind of want to introduce what do we think about when we hear Vasicek bond pricing problem. Okay. So that would be a nice application of Itô lemma, of the SDF, market prices of risk, Gesanov theorem. Four concepts that in other office hours we've already talked about. So what did Vasicek do? Vasicek assumed that the interest rate is Gaussian distributed. Yeah. So he kind of says that in the data under the P probability measure, the change of the interest rate has some AR1 structure, right? The way he writes there, this he says, okay, there's some speed of mean reversion, kappa. There is some long run mean to the interest rate, R upper bar minus RT dt plus, and then there's a Gaussian shock. There's a constant volatility, and that gets multiplied by a Brownian motion shock, which is just a Gaussian random variable, mean of zero, and the variance being dt. Okay, so let's say that's my equation one. Okay, Gaussian distribution, yeah, kind of the short rate, the law of motion or the distribution of RT is just Gauss. Okay, now what he also assumes is that the stochastic discount factor has the following shape. Yeah, that at least is implicitly assumed. I just followed the notation from our lecture notes. So DMT, that's the change in the SDF. I take a minus here, is nothing else than RT dt. Now that is RT. And then we have plus the market price of risk for interest rate risk times the systematic risk in the economy, and that will be the shock to the risk-free rate. Yeah, that's the same B. Okay. Now, what Vasicek is assuming in the model is that this lambda TR, this market price of interest rate risk, is just a linear function or an affine function in the interest rate itself. Yeah, and lambda 0 is in R, and lambda 1 is also a constant in R. Okay. What you now therefore do is you apply Gesanov theorem. Yeah? By applying the Gesanov theorem, you know that you can rewrite equation one under the risk-neutral probability measure. You therefore know that DRT equals, based on what we have in equation one, it's kappa p, it's the long-run mean of interest rates minus the interest rate, dt, plus sigma r. Okay, and what do we do now? Now, what is Gesanov theorem saying? Gesanov theorem says that, let's start from here. If you have a Brownian motion under P, yeah, let's be general. You have a Brownian motion under P, you know the market price of risk, lambda t dt, then that is nothing else than a Brownian motion under the risk-neutral measure Q. Okay, therefore, that is BP. So we need to rewrite that, and we're now writing that as dBr, that's a shock to the interest rate, but now under Q. Now minus the market price of risk for interest rate risk. Okay, so what do we have? Maybe let's just look at that part. We have sigma r minus lambda RT dt plus sigma r Brownian motion under Q. Okay, now you see why the assumption of Markowitz is important, not of Markowitz, I apologize, of Vasicek is important, because he assumed that the lambda RT has this affine relationship. Yeah, maybe if I call that equation, what do we have? We have equation one, so let's call that equation two. Then by equation two, that has this linear shape. So therefore, let's just work with that. So we use the equation two. And let's multiply these constants out. Yeah, so we have speed of mean reversion, long run mean, minus speed of mean reversion, RT. And now we have minus sigma r lambda 0 from here. Let me give that a little r index. So we really know it's the market price for interest rate risk. Okay, and then we have minus sigma r lambda 1 r times rt. Okay, that will now be the drift under Q. And then plus our Brownian motion shock. Let's make it a nice B. BRQT. Okay, so what we now do is we are grouping terms in constant terms and in terms that are affine in R. So there's a big parenthesis here. Let's say we have kappa PRP, it's this part. Now we have minus sigma R lambda 0 R. Okay. Plus. Let me use a minus. Yeah, minus. Okay, now we have kappa p, and here we have plus sigma r lambda 1 r, and that gets multiplied by rt. That's our dt, and now we are adding the Brownian motion shock under q. Okay, so we now want these expressions to look nice. So therefore, one thing we do is we change the color. Okay, now I wanted that term to be named, that's the constant part. That's the constant part, which in P, the equivalence would be the product of these two things. I therefore want that to be kappa Q times R upper bar Q. I want that part to be the equivalence. Here is basically, I just want that to be kappa Q. Okay, let's formally define, therefore, the new variables that we introduce, which is kappa Q and R upper bar under Q. Okay, so note the following. We basically want that kappa q times r upper bar q, we want that to be the same thing, just by definition, so we want that to be equivalent to this expression kappa p rp minus sigma r lambda 0 r. Okay, and we also want that thing, kappa p plus sigma r lambda 1 r, we want that to be equivalent to kappa q. Okay, so therefore we already have defined kappa q. Very nice. And now we just need to formally define r upper bar q. So we go from that equation and divide by kappa q. So we see that r bar q needs just to be defined to be kappa p rp minus sigma r lambda 0 r. And now we divide that by kappa q. But kappa q is nothing else than kappa p plus sigma r lambda 1 r. Okay. Meaning, if we define r upper bar q like that, if we define kappa q like that, then it follows, let's call that here equation 3. Now, then it follows from equation 3 that in the Vasicek specification, that the change, or let's again change the color back to the original color, which was something like that. So we have now drt equals kappa q rq minus rt dt plus sigma r dbqrt. Let's again double check. Kappa q times r bar q is this part. It will be that part. That's precisely what we need. And then kappa q minus rt, so it's minus kappa q rt. That's the minus, that's the kappa q, it needs to be that, and the kappa q will indeed be that expression. Okay, so that's correct. Let's just for summary purpose rewrite or restate the Vasicek dynamic under P. Right, so that basically is now with the assumption of our market price of risk being affine in the interest rate, that's what it looks like under Q. And now we started off with the assumption that under P, the dynamic of the interest rate is like that. Okay, so therefore, some intuition, having a linear market price of risk in the interest rate allows us to kind of say that in the data, relative to the, or in the data, and under the P measure, the long run mean and the speed of mean reversion in interest rates can differ from the long run mean and the speed of mean reversion that is priced in into instruments that depend on the short rate. Yeah, and the reason why they differ is precisely because if the shock is precisely that the shocks to interest rates is a systematic shock, so it pays a risk premium, and risk premium is constant plus a linear part in the risk-free rate, and what we just showed in that video is I can rewrite it like that. Yeah, so these are different parameters. Okay, so that was just to get started with what is Vasicek, but the goal of that video was to apply Feynman-Karch to Vasicek. Yeah, so let's again, last time, let's change the color. Let's take brown, oh, let's take a bigger. Okay, so let's do an application where we apply Feynman-Karch to Vasicek bond pricing. Okay, so again, that relies on some concepts we've already talked about, risk neutral pricing and Feynman-Karch. So what is the price of a bond? Now, let's say the price of a bond is determined, is called to be B, the bond price. Okay, I want to change that, make it, let's call it P. I have a price of a bond, let's say S of time T, and the bond is going to mature in T minus T. Okay. Now, by risk neutral pricing, we know that what's the price? I just think about what's the cash flow. Yeah, so I get a euro in T minus T periods from now, and that needs to be discounted. Here I use the risk-free rate as the discount factor, and therefore I know I need to take the expectation under the risk-neutral measure. Okay, if that's unclear, go back to the tutorial of risk-neutral pricing. Okay, now we want to talk about about Feynman-Karch. So therefore, we will define that pricing function to be some general function u, which depends on time, because we take the expectation as of little t. It depends on our state variable. Here the only state variable that we have is r, and it depends on that constant time to maturity t. Okay. Could also say here t minus small t, but that doesn't matter. Okay. So what's now Feynman-Karch saying? Well, the Feynman-Karch theorem says that that conditional expectation, which is just the u, solves the following partial differential equation. Yeah, so by the Feynman-Karch theorem, we know that at t equals t, keep in mind, that just means that t minus t is zero, right? Now we know that at maturity, the value of the bond, so let's say t r comma cap t, will just be equal to the payoff, which is 1. Yeah? So at maturity, the euro we receive is really worth a euro. That's what that condition tells us. Now for t smaller than capital T and larger than 0, we have that the u, which we want to solve for, has to solve, Femenkatsch, it's r t times u of t, comma rt t, and that needs to be equal to the generator of my u function plus the first derivative of u with regard to t. Okay, and remember, what would be the generator of the u function? Okay, so that generator itself, it was defined that we take the first derivative of the u function with regard to the state. Here it's one dimensional, it's just the rt. And we evaluate that at t, rt, and cap t. And now that gets multiplied by the drift of the e to diffusion for r. Okay, here's something I want to highlight. Things that sometimes students get wrong. The expectation here is under q. That's important. It's a financial concept why we can do that. Right? If that's unclear, we have a video for that. Risk-neutral pricing. I therefore want to highlight that the generator of the function is under q. I'm highlighting that because I now multiply that by the expectation s of t of drt under q. That's important. What is that part of what we've done before? This is just kappa q times r upper bar q minus rt dt. Okay, that's important. You really now see why we tend to say that based on prices, we can extract the risk neutral dynamics, so the risk neutral parameters, because you really see it depends on the q parameters, not on the p parameters. Okay. And then the second part of the generator is just that we have to adjust half the second derivative of u with regard to the state variable. We evaluate that again at these, and now that gets multiplied by the variance of the diffusion, which is just sigma r square dt. Okay, so I could therefore, since I'm explicitly writing in here the dt's, yeah, I can think about I have a dt here and I have a dt here, but these things are going to cancel out with these parts. So therefore, in the original Feynman-Katsch, we don't have the dt explicitly. But here you might ask, where's the dt coming in? You could write it in, but then just it's going to cancel out. Okay, so now we have applied the Feynman-Katsch because rt, that's our state variable, it's known. U, it's what we want to solve for. We have a terminal value condition. And now we have the generator. And generator is also well defined. We take the first derivative, that is known. Based on the assumption of Fassi check, that is known. And if we know u, we know the second derivative. Okay, so what's the remaining problem? Yeah, so the open issue that we have is that u is unknown. Of course, we want to solve for u. So the open issue is that the method for determining the u is called the guess and verify method. That's a method that is often used for different types of applications. Guess and verify method. So we kind of guess what the solution looks like for u. We plug the solution into that Feynman-Katsch partial differential equation and verify that the guess is correct. If we cannot verify that, of course, it means the guess was wrong. Yeah? But the literature developed, so we kind of already know what the solution structure of such a problem looks like, where the interest rate here has is of the affine class. And I just give you the guess, and then we make another video where we explicitly solve for the missing loading. Basically, we are going to verify that the guess is correct. Therefore, the guess will be the following. The guess is that the price of that bond as of time t for any interest rate r with time to maturity, yeah, again, we guess, it looks the following. It's an exponential function that has a constant part, and then there is some linear part in RT. Do we know something else? Well, we know that U needs to be 1 at time to maturity. Yeah. So from that condition, we already know that since U of T R, and let's say T, at a position where T equals cap T, so if we're at maturity, that needs to be 1. Okay? It therefore means that that must be 1 if T is cap T, meaning if that is 0, that is 0, the entire expression needs to be 1. We therefore know that these loadings must be 0, must be 0 and 0 if T equals cap T. Therefore, we know that AQ of 0 needs to be the same than BQ of 0, and that needs to be 0. So we have an initial or terminal. We will decide that once we do the formal calculation. It will turn out it's a terminal value condition. So we have a terminal value condition that our loadings that we need to specify need to be 0 at time to maturity. And what we now have to solve is, what do these loadings look like for time periods prior to time to maturity? And therefore, we just take the guess, plug it into that Feynman-Kutch PDE, and then solve the ODEs. That takes some minutes, therefore we do an extra video for that.